Hi, Jill, finally back. I know it's been a long while. My brain's been melty because I'm not on my ADHD medication where there's a shortage. So it's been a struggle. So I'll go to work, get done with work, and then I'm dead for the rest of the day. Like my brain just, there's no function whatsoever in it. So I'm back. Hopefully this angle works, because I'm doing this on my phone, because every time I had tried to do something on my MacBook, it just doesn't save. So we're going with this. I'm continuing my rabbit hole of missing and murdered men in the Midwest. I've had this post, typed up for a while. It was just chaos, and I finally just sat down and organized it. Well, I had time. I'm going to make a fried pickle. You know, if you're on the TikTok, then you've seen this. So I'm using pepper jack, which has apparently become my new favorite cheese, and mild cheddar. So you have to let the cheese just whatever melt down to a nice consistency, which is a struggle actually. And while this does this, I am going to tell you about the disappearance of Kevin Mahoney. So let's get into it. I almost didn't do this one because it happened in North Dakota, but where it was so close to Minnesota, when I got to looking at it again, I decided, okay, let's go ahead and do this one. Also, if you look at Kevin Mahoney, there are a bajillion results that pulls up. And I actually realized I had heard about this case from, there's a podcast called The Banished, where they cover just disappearances of people. Marisha. Wonderful. Marisha? I don't know. Her voice is so soothing. She does very such good research. I included her. I linked her episode in the show notes. So, I will start off with, there are some conflicting statements from when Kevin went missing. His mother last saw him on September 30th. And a couple of friends confirmed the same thing. However, later a friend stated that the following day, October 1st. And the police also had it listed as October 2nd. There's a lot of misinformation with this case, from the police having the wrong date, misspelling of names, mislabeling their sisters and friends as cousins or what have you. Oh, jeez. Watch me burn this cheese. So, we're going to start with, I'm going to dry up a pickle. So I can get this pickle down. I'm using pickle spears. I usually use the flat pickles. But I'm going to dry it off a little bit. Ooh, I've already burnt this cheese. It's crispy. And then I'd like to sprinkle some garlic salt on it. Or some garlic powder. And then I'm going to flip it. This is actually, maybe I should have done this for another episode, since this was a quick little thing. I'm not good on the rolling part, but these are quick, simple, and delicious. So, let me get a plate. So, on September 30th, 1993, 25-year-old Kevin Mahoney disappeared after leaving a friend's house in Fargo, North Dakota. People partying that night, at the house in question, told police he left about 1 a.m. on foot, heading to his brother's place in South Moorhead. I'm gonna put this on a plate and let it cool while I finish telling you about Kevin. I eat this with some ranch, but it's real hot right now. But that's what it looks like. Put that right there. Things. Hopefully I don't sit down on this. I'm not going to. That would be a disaster. All the cheese. I put out a lot of cheese and then only used 2 or 3 pounds. So, what do we have? I'm a disaster, dear lady friends. I'm sorry. So, let me tell you. So, he left at 1 a.m. on foot, heading to his brother's house. Which I Google mapped this. There, it's a 46 minute walk. So it would have been 2.3 miles from his friend's house in Moorhead to his from his friend's house in Fargo to Moorhead. So for three decades, they've been trying to find answers for this case. So I have some facts about the night he disappeared. Like I said, he left the house around 1 a.m. Kevin's friends stated he called some family, but no one has, he called his brother. His brother was actually out of town. So it's not known if Kevin ever actually showed up at his house, but that he also called some other family, but that's not been verified. He did call his friend Lena for a ride that night, but she wasn't able to go. She did go down to the house a couple days later and found a pair of jeans with blood on them, but they were a 34-34, which wasn't Kevin's size. His family did state that he would sometimes borrow clothes that would be too big for him. The police didn't actually take this case seriously in the beginning until years later. The cold case investigators took a look at his file. I'm going to move this over here so I can read. So the cold case investigators took a look at his file and then determined foul play to be involved. This is a process. In 2007, so there are some theories of what happened to Kevin. In 2007, someone said that he was killed at Ben's and put in the wall or buried under the floor in the basement. They have dug up the concrete in the basement, and the family doesn't believe that they dug down deep enough. But there is 120 photos that are on the Vanish's website, if you want to look at those. And there was a hole in the cinder blocks that the owners after Ben found, which it was a 2x2 wall. So they checked and they didn't find anything to suggest a body had ever been in there. There was a rumor that he got into a fight with someone after a wedding and that the dude came back after revenge. But this dude also said that he got out of the car and beat him with some nunchucks. I'll get to that in a minute. There was a rumor that someone gave him drugs and he overdosed. A rumor that he was killed and put in a wood chipper. Someone said that he was done like Jenna North, who is an 11-year-old girl who was kidnapped and murdered. Her killer did state that he disposed of her body by tying a rope around her body and weighing it down with a cinder block in the river. She's never been found, though, but there was a lot of floodings after that happened. There was a... Oh, what year did she happen? Hold on. She happened in 93, in June of 93. So Kevin happened in October of the same year. There was also a rumor that he was put in a meat grinder at Federal Beef, which is also rumored to what someone said happened to Jenna North as well. So suspects that we have for this, Ben, of course, his friend whose house he was at that night, he got into a fight with Kevin before he left, and he gave some conflicting statements to the police. Apparently they were working to fix up his house that he had just gotten in the divorce, and they got in a fight about a door measurement, and then there was another something that said about a window. So Ben did have the conflicting statements, and he was never confronted about those statements. He did give a polygraph test 3 months later, but they only asked him three questions. They asked about the fight and then about the door. Lonnie, who is the guy that said Kevin got into an argument with him at a wedding and that he got out of the car and beat him up with nunchucks, and that the guy vowed to seek revenge, which sounds wild, like who just pulls out nunchucks? Then there's Phil. Phil said that Kevin was involved in a drug deal with the Mexican mafia, and that if he didn't kill Kevin, they would have killed him. He killed him and then put him where Jenna North was, which they said was the meat grinder at Federal Beef. When they reached out to Phil, they said he said they were barking up the wrong tree. So there's nothing tying Kevin to Phil. And then finally, the unlikely one is maybe Kevin just walked away. His family does not think that. And from the information that you get from his family, he doesn't seem like that type of person. But you can't rule it out because you never know what's going through someone's mind sometimes. And the only reason I even put this one in there is because there was a woman at Rick's bar in Fargo about a month after his disappearance that said he was at the bar, but this has never been proven. So that's that information. Kevin is a tall dude. He honestly looks like Sebastian Bach a lot, which is who I thought this was when I looked at pictures. And I'll have a picture in the post I put up with this. So each year in the days before his anniversary of his disappearance, Kevin's family takes to the streets of Fargo holding up signs with his face on it, and case on them, just in case someone recognizes him at random. They're trying to keep his memory alive, as you should. And they want to remind the community, hey, this is still a thing. They have also been putting up flyers, but someone's been taking them down. So I don't know if that's, you know, maybe someone's taking them down thinking, hey, this guy's been missing since 93, whatever, or they're taking them down to put up other posters, or what. My air purifier hates me. So there's not really any indicator of what that is, or if it's maybe one of the suspects who's guilty. There was also, it was said that, when Kevin was alive, his friends used to come by the house a lot, even Ben, but after he died, they've not checked in on the family. They've not done anything, and they just stopped coming around, which is weird. But I don't know if maybe it's a hard subject for them, but if my friend went missing, I would definitely go check in on their mom. You know? Look at that crunchy. It's a little burnt. So, if you have any information about Kevin's disappearance, I'll include that in the show notes as well. And then I'm going to continue on with my rabbit hole of this. That's delicious. So I'm gonna try to get more of these out. I already have one film that I've not done. Let me know of any that you want me to cover. I do have a master list of all of the ones that are in there if you want to look at that and have any feedback. Also, if you have any more information that I missed, I feel like I've missed something going through this. If I've missed something, please correct me. So stay safe, be good, watch after each other. Until next time.